When millions depend on lighthearted interviews, unverified information on YouTube or viral TikTok videos, do you get a sense somehow that Filipinos have become lazy, that we lack a general sense of inquisitiveness, that we're ready to accept whatever flow of information, hook, line, and sinker?
I chair a group called the Movement Against Disinformation, which my only regret is we organized it too late. We organized it in November. We should have organized it 4 years ago. And trying to find various ways. I won't blame the people, and I won't blame the Filipino citizens. This is true all over the world, first of all, right? So it's not like we Filipinos are like this, Americans are not like this, and Chinese are not. This is true all over the world. This information is true all over the world. The problem is social media platforms, because the social media platforms do not own responsibility for what's in their platforms. Unlike you guys, and you guys can sometimes be mistaken, but you own what you say, and you own what you tell us, right? And we can go after you or complain, and there are processes, editorially, etc., to deal with that. The problem is the social media platforms, by the nature of the business, of the design of their algorithms, is they say we are not responsible for what people put out there. That's the one that has to change, because it destroys democracy. It can even be very physically harmful, like red tagging. For example, a lawyer for indigenous peoples, for Lumad peoples, Lumad schools in Mindanao, and they've just been red tagged and attacked physically. And one of my clients was actually killed because of that, Mr. Chad Book. You know, the thing is that the social media platforms do not take accountability for what's put there. So we have to figure out, without, and here's the challenge, without violating freedom of expression, freedom of the press, you know, the ability of people to interact with each other, because that's good. So how do you do that is a challenge. We've started the work around that on the legal part. There's lots of fact checkers now. I think traditional media is starting to rise up to that occasion. That's quite ironic, right? That you are the ones now that has to
that we are now on the defensive.
Others, I mean, you don't have to be defensive anymore. You're our allies. I consider broadcast, radio, TV, and print media as our allies in this fight against disinformation, because you've also been affected by this.
Because for someone who hasn't lived through martial law, the Marcos myth. There's a Marcos myth. It's the golden age of the economy. What happens to that, Dean? What happens to
that? There was no golden age of the economy under Marcos.
What happens? I mean, is this vindication for the Marcoses?
No.
Victory?
No, here, that's why I kept on emphasizing. This is a combination. This was not just a big night of the Marcoses. This was a big night of the Dutertes as well. And ironically, without the father, the father endorsed the daughter, but the father did not really endorse Marcos, right? But this is a big night for both of them, because this is a combination of both of them. This is not a vindication of the Marcos family, because if, as I said, if Sara Duterte ran for president, this would be a three-way race, or certainly there would be no certainty that Marcos would win over Sara Duterte. Let's be very clear about that. The brilliance of Marcos, and I have to say that, and I have to acknowledge that, of the Marcos campaign, and the discipline also of that, is that he convinced Sara Duterte to lie down to Vice President, convince her to stay on with her, push back gently the President on all the attacks without fighting the President. That says something about him as well.
Although, of course, I remember maybe in one interview where Mayor Sara Duterte, when she was asked if she was ready to run for the presidency, I think she mentioned, no, I'd rather let two administrations run their course before I actually make a run for the presidency. And that would put it at about 2034, I think. So I don't know if this would actually accelerate her timetable now that she's, you know, expected to become vice president.
Well, you can expect she'll run, and but she might have to run against a Marcos. there's a couple of Marcoses out there that that's ready to run as well, right?
Yeah, so right.
We'll see. But promises like that, you know, I mean, I mean, even Bepi Lenny, whom I really liked, actually said she was not going to run, right? I mean, people always say they don't run. Some mean it like VP Lenny, and for me, that's also one mistake. I mean, I think as vice president, she should have always considered that she might be running and prepare for that, right?
Yeah.
But that was her choice. She really chose not to prepare until the last 10 days of the filing. Mm-hmm. I mean, we know the story, how she ended up eventually running, and I respect her for that. But Sarah really didn't want to run for president.
Yeah.
And my sense is because she didn't want to become president on
so
his
soon
father's,
after her father,
and also on his father's support. Because if she ran, I can sort of bet that, assuming that in fact the dynamics remain the same, they should probably win. She would probably have won over Marcos. But with the help of the father, right?
Yeah.
Because she would have the local machinery.
Yeah.
Right now, none of the candidates had the local machinery, because President Duterte did not, endorse anyone, and the local machinery, many went to Marcos, but quite a number went to Robredo as well, and some to Isko Moreno.